with hip-hop music.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So I've got to ask you one question. You know, people ask me, Joe, where's your tan? Did you notice the beautiful beaches and the hotels and the pink sand in that? There was none. It was not what I would call a vacation by no means at all. Let me just give you a little bit of background. During the latter part of 2018, my granddaughter Emily wanted to go to Ireland, and so my wife went, my daughter went, left me home for about a week. And so I figured I got to do something. So I wanted to go to Israel originally, but that was quite an experience. It got quite expensive. So friend of mine who used to attend here, Jack Wilson, used to attend here about 25, 30 years ago. We became very, very good friends. He became a pastor in the Philippines, in the Payatas area. Now, Payatas area is, people go, where is that? I speak to Filipinos that don't even know where it's at, all right? It's north of Manila, the main town, northeast of the main town, about 25, 28 miles northeast. It is a very, very impoverished area. The area is known for its dump site. There is a mountain there that's approximately just shy 2.5 or 3 square miles, goes about 900 feet high, and it's garbage. All garbage. You'll notice some of the streets in the photo where I was walking down. That whole town is around a garbage dump. It is so big. Matter of fact, they had to finally put controls on it back about just shy 20 years ago. It had a landslide, and over 200 people were killed in that as a landslide. Well, my friend Jack met his wife Melu and became a missionary over there. So Jack told me, he says, Joe, all it takes is an airplane trip. I said, that's all you got to pay for. And he says, then you can come on over. So I decided to do that. I had been on one mission trip before to Nicaragua 2 years ago. And that was an eye-opener. It really is. It really was. And so I decided to go to the Philippines to see my friend Jack, Pastor Jack, who's got a church over that way. And so I started to take a look at, what I was going to need as far as shots and stuff like that. And I'll give you a quick little list. You know, they were telling me that I needed thyroid, typhoid, and all sorts of things. And after a while, I started reading, going through that list. And I decided that, I don't know if I really want to go there. And then my daughter, Cindy, said to me, Dad, she says, Dad, come on. You got to have more faith in that. You got to be braver than that. I contacted Jack Wilson. We were Skyping, Skyping back and forth. And I asked him, I says, well, what kind of shots do I need? He goes, what shots? You know, you don't need shots. I said, well, I'm nervous. He says, Joe, where's your faith? And I'm going, okay, another one who says the same thing to me. Turned out that I ended up only getting one shot, which was for hepatitis A. That's where I decided going. And to chance it on my own the rest of the way. So I got onto a plane, a Philippines airline, and we traveled 16 hours nonstop. Now, can you imagine sitting in your seat right now and not moving maybe for three times? Maybe you might move up three times for 16 hours.
Praise the Lord.
All right? I would get up periodically to hit the men's room or get up and just do some exercise. Well, it turned out that I ended up going, and I was picked up by their assistant pastor, Pastor Ben, and he was in there. There was a picture of him and his wife, Rosalie, was in there too. And it, so he picked me up at the airport. At first, I didn't see him. I got a little bit nervous. So he's driving, and the streets and the traffic is another thing, which I'll sum up at the end a little bit about it. So he's driving. He's going through the main town. We're heading to the church. It was about, like I said, from the airport, it was about 25 miles away. And I'm looking around. You know, I'm a regular guy. I mean, I'm no different than any of you people, really. I'm no different. I consider myself the same as you, if not less sometimes. And I'm traveling over there, and I'm looking around, and I'm going, I want to go home. I want to go. I was ready to turn over. I was that far away from telling Pastor Ben, take me back to the airport. So we arrive at the church. We check. I drop off there, and I'm looking around. Finally, go over to Jack's place, and I was staying at Jack's place for the 10 days that I was there, and then. So we went back to the church on Saturday. Now, Saturday is really kind of a unique day over there. I'll tell you right now, you, Pastor, are easy. You are very easy. They're not easy over there. They're very structured, very, very strict. Everyone shows up on Saturday. Why? For one main reason. They go out and they knock on doors every Saturday. They don't just leave tags. They knock on doors, and then they go back. And so it's quite a bit different. And the thing is, you got to go. All right? Sunday service, you got to go. Wednesday night, prayer meeting, you got to go. Jack is very, very strict. If you don't go, don't bother coming back. All right? Now, us as Americans, we would say, forget about it. We won't even deal with that. But Jack, the people love him. The people there love him. So Saturday we went around and we started going through the little village around the dump site. And I was quite taken back at what I saw. This is a small taste of what I saw. It was without a doubt. I thought Nicaragua was a shocker for me. This was even more so of a shocker for me. On Sunday, after service, everybody participates, by the way. Like even in prayer meeting, he expects you to be prepared with notes during prayer meeting when they do the Bible study. So on Sunday morning, we had our first worship, and I played a song there. It turned out that that particular weekend was Jack and Melu's 20th anniversary. So afterwards, we sat there, and I was able to play and entertain the kids. And all the kids, by the way, even the littlest kids are in the orchestra. They play harmonica, the little kids. Everybody, Jack's got a phenomenal music ministry. He is not musically talented himself, but they got violins, guitars, harmonicas, keyboard, everything. Violins and so forth. I'm going to try and cut it a little short. Kristen, I could go on and on for this. Anyway, so it turned out we had a great time on that Sunday. One of the things that I just want to highlight in a couple things, the living over there, traffic, as I mentioned to you, I sought to mention, traffic over there was made New York City look like nothing. The roads over there, the traffic laws are for suggestions. You drive on any side of the street you want, as long as you're in front of somebody. And it's extremely, extremely congested with things called jeepneys, trikes, motorcycles. I mean, I could never drive there. I mean, I've driven across country, and I would never even attempt to drive there. I was concerned about the food because I was concerned I was going to get sick, so I took probiotics on my way there. Never got sick. I did very well with that. Jack had bottled water plus filtered water, which I was able to. By the way, if you ever watched the movie It's a Mad, 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 Mad World with people driving crazy, that's exactly what it was like. Okay? Jack has Pastor Jack has a vision for his church. He wants to, his church is from this room, it's approximately maybe about one-fourth the size of this, if not, maybe even less. But he's got a vision of building a bigger church because he's got a lot of people. The adults, the kids, very, very loving. I fell in love with the kids. Every day they came over to me and hugging me, you know. I'm just kind of curious, how many people have, I'll tell you what, I'm going to make it easy. How many have been on a missions trip? Okay. The rest of you who have not, you have to go. You have no idea the difference between the cultures, what we have here in America. We are so spoiled. So spoiled. Over there, they have nothing. But they're happy. They're very, very happy. Beautiful people. I'll leave you with a couple things. Isaiah 6:8. And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for me?" And then said I, "Here I am, send me." I had someone ask me, "Why do you do this? Why do I do this?" I know I did it late in life, and I'm going to be 73 years old, and I did it. I've done it now a couple times, and you people who are a lot younger than me, please take that opportunity to do that if you get the chance. The song that I sang for Jack, that Sunday morning service, kind of sums it all. Because the song really is asking, you know, why me? Why me? Why me, Lord? What have I ever done to deserve even one of the pleasures that I've owned? Tell me, Lord, what did I ever do that was worth love from you? All that kindness you showed. Help me, Jesus, I know what I am. Now that I know that I need you so, help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hand. Try me, Lord, if you think there's a way that I can repay all I've taken from you. Maybe, Lord, I can show someone else what I've been through myself on my way back to you. Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted. Help me, Jesus, I know what I am. Now that I know that I needed you so, help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hand. Help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hand.